Our Father, we thank Thee for the privilege we have today of opening Thy Word to study. And dear Lord God, as we study today, lead us by the Spirit, and we'll give God the praise in Jesus' name. Supply the needs of this broadcast, our Father, and save souls, and may this program truly always be the Gospel Hour. And our Father, may the pure, unadulterated Word of God go out daily through this program, and we'll give God the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, today we are continuing our study, and will continue throughout the rest of the days of this month, the book of Ephesians. First of all, we studied the word A-double-L. We found there are 27 besides the two in chapter 2 of Ephesians. In chapter 2 of Ephesians, verse 3, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, or the children of the devil. Now then, in verse 21, in whom all the building, fitly framed together, groweth into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. All in the same boat, sinners, and then thank God, all in the same body, the body of Christ. Now, we talked about that on yesterday. Now, in chapter 3, we find another precious, precious gospel revelation. For this cause, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God. Now, who said the Bible is not a book of dispensational truth? One reason that people hate the Scofield Bible, and I say people, I should say primarily ministers, had a letter from a dear Christian today, and this dear Christian said that this particular preacher just lambasted the Scofield Bible and run it down to the dogs. Now, let me tell you something. The only reason that some people hate the Scofield Bible, in the notes at the bottom of the page, and in the references and the helps that Dr. Scofield left in this great Bible that bears his name, the Scofield Reference Bible, it's an authorized King James Version. The only reason they hate it, it teaches the premillennial coming of Jesus, the Spirit-filled life, and grace minus law. That's the reason they hate it. Now then, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which is given me to you. Now listen. How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Now Paul said, what I preach, what I teach, and the gospel that I proclaim was given to me by revelation. These words are not my words. These words are not the words of a man, Paul is saying, but the words that I speak and the gospel that I preach was given to me by revelation. Now listen, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. Now here's the mystery, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Now that's the secret. It was Paul who said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Again, it was Paul who said, I preached unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. He was buried, and he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. That's 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 3. Now, listen, beloved. You can follow the tradition of men if you want to. You can follow denominations if you want to. You can follow man-made programs if you want to. But I'm going to follow the gospel of the grace of God as declared and preached and pinned down by the Apostle Paul, by revelation. How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body, and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I am made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God, given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me who am less than the least of all saints is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now under the principalities and powers heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God according to the eternal purpose, which is purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of Him. Now it's Jesus. It's Jesus. I told you when I started this series, many outstanding Bible scholars have made statements similar to this statement. Ephesians is the divine unfolding of God in the man of men. Ephesians is the divine unfolding of God in the man of men. The man of men. Now that's Jesus. Now here's what Paul is saying. The mystery of the Gentiles becoming fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of the promise of God, it is all made possible by Jesus Christ. God forbid that I should glory save in the cross, Paul said. God forbid. Now, here's what I want you to see today. Beloved, the only way that you or I or anybody else can ever please God, the only way that you or I or anybody else can ever be saved, the only way that you or I or anyone else shall ever enter the pearly gates is by and through the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, it was in the beginning the plan of God. God foreordained that Jesus would pay the sin debt before God ever laid the foundation of this world. Read 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, 19, 20, and following. Jesus was foreordained of God to die for the sins of sinners. And in the fullness of time, Jesus came, born of a woman, born under the law, that he might redeem us from the curse of the law. And by the grace of God, he took upon himself a body. He was made a little lower than the angels, that he might taste death for every man. So God is pleased, highly pleased, with the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And then that's in Matthew 3. Then in Matthew chapter 17, the Mount of Transfiguration, God said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." Hear him. Now, beloved, if you want to stay out of hell, hear the word. I walk in the light. Hear the word. Hear the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, Paul said in Romans 10:17. So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We are born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible by the word of God. Now, this mystery of the Gentiles becoming fellow heirs, members of his body, and partakers of his spirit, this mystery was hidden down through the Old Testament era, but in this dispensation of the grace of God, it is revealed, this great mystery is made known by revelation to the Apostle Paul, and he pinned down the marvelous truths, and we have them in the letters that bear his name. Now, that is the letters that he wrote to the different churches. 13 of these New Testament epistles are attributed to the Apostle Paul. Now, he said, "I got my message. I received my message by revelation." That's verse 3. Ephesians 3 and verse 3. "How that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery," as I wrote afore in a few words, "whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs," and so on. Now, here's what I want you to see today. Here's what I want you to hear today. Here's what I want you to believe today. And I want you to receive today so that you'll be in that number when the saints go marching in. Now, in the Old Testament era, God dealt with the Jews, Israel, God's chosen people, the elect of God, the chosen of God, the people, Israel, God's chosen. But When the king came, they rejected the king. They nailed him to a cross. They crowned him with a crown of thorns. And Pilate said, Whom shall I release? And they said, Barabbas. And Pilate said, What shall I do with Jesus? And they said, We'll not have this man to reign over us. Let his blood be upon us and upon our children. Now listen. They killed the king. They crucified the king. They crowned him with a crown of thorns. And God, on the road to Damascus, God called, ordained, commissioned, and equipped the Apostle Paul, Saul of Tarsus, with blood in his eyes, murder in his heart, warrants in his pocket, was on his way to Damascus to arrest the Christians, to persecute the church, to kill Christians, and to bring them back, both men and women, bound and throw them in the dungeons. But God spoke to Saul as he traveled the Damascus road. He fell to the earth and he said, Lord, who art thou? And he said, This is Jesus whom thou persecutest. And then Saul said, What wilt thou have me to do? And he said, You go into the city and you'll be instructed. Paul arose, he was blind, and they led him to the city. And he went to the house of Simon. Ananias met him, laid his hands on him, and he told him that God had sent him, and that Saul was a chosen vessel, and his eyes were open, he was baptized, and in Acts 9, Saul of Tarsus preached Jesus in the synagogues, that he is the Son of God. Now then, in the same book, in Acts, when Paul was giving his testimony before Felix, he said, on the Damascus Road, he gave his testimony. He gave his experience. And he said that God spoke to him and told him that he was making him a minister to the Gentiles. And he said, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. I was not disobedient. I obeyed. I carried the message. I went to the Gentiles. I preached to the Gentiles. I preached to the Jew, the Gentile, the rich, the poor, the bond, the free. I preached the gospel of the marvelous grace of God to all. Now listen, beloved. In this marvelous dispensation of grace, God saves whosoever will. If there is a dear Jewish person listening to my voice today, you can become a member of the Church of the Living God, a member of the body of Christ. You can become a member of the household of God, the family of God, by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. But I say to you, it makes no difference who you are. There is no other name under heaven given whereby we must be saved. It's Jesus. There is no cleansing from sin apart from the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son. Now, all of this was hidden in the Old Testament era. Yes, it was prophesied that he would come. As a lamb, he would be led to the slaughter. As a sheep before her shearers is dumb, he openeth not his mouth. But listen. Those dear men, when Jesus came, they were looking for a great king, a colorful king, a dynamic personality. Jesus came as a lamb, humble, submissive. He came to lay his life down. They couldn't see it. They could not accept him. They would not accept him. They did not accept him. They nailed him to a cross. But, beloved, it's all in the program of God that we poor Gentiles might be partakers of divine nature, fellow heirs, members of the body of Christ, and thank God that we might become sons of God, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Jesus. Now it's by grace, through faith, not yourselves, not of works, not your righteousness, because all of your righteousnesses are as filthy rags. There is none good, no, not one. We've all gone astray. All of us had our conversation in the lust of the flesh. We were all children of wrath. But thank God now all who will believe, all who will receive, the Lord Jesus Christ can become members of the body of the Lord Jesus, body of Christ, members of his body, bone of his bone, and flesh of his flesh. He's the head of the church. He's the foundation of the church. Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, in the Old Testament, that was a mystery. But it was revealed, it was made known to Paul by revelation. Now, listen to some of the words of this man. He said in Romans 10, Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Now, listen, that's quite a contrast, isn't it, to the road to Damascus experience. When Saul of Tarsus was traveling the road to Damascus. He had letters in his pockets from the high priest to arrest all who were in the Jesus way. All in the Jesus way. He consented to the stoning of Stephen. Now, he says, brethren, my heart's desire, my prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. Now, he said, I bear them record they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. Now, you see, God had made known unto Paul by revelation the mystery of the grace of God. Now, he said, I'm telling you this so that you'll know where I got my knowledge. All right. He, too, was blinded when he started down the road to Damascus. But his eyes were open. Even though he could not see the light of day, his spiritual eyes were open when he fell to the ground. And he said, Jesus, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do, Jesus? And Jesus instructed him. He followed the instruction of Jesus. He obeyed the words of Jesus. And he became the mighty apostle to whom God dictated 13 of these precious New Testament epistles. Now then, let's get back. He said, I bear them record. They have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. They are religious, but it's not according to knowledge. They're zealous, but it's not according to knowledge. They are devout, but it's not according to knowledge. Listen, beloved, you may be a good Baptist, but that doesn't mean you're saved. You may support the Baptist program, give to the Baptist program, attend the Baptist church. You may have been baptized. You may be a deacon in the Baptist church. You may be a good Baptist, but that doesn't mean you're saved. You may be a good Methodist, but that doesn't mean you're saved. You may be a good Presbyterian, but that doesn't mean you're saved. You may be a good holiness, but that doesn't mean you're saved. So far as somebody putting their finger on habits of sin in your life, they may not be able to find one thing wrong with your daily living, but that doesn't mean you're saved. We're not saved by religion, church membership, baptism, good living. We're saved by grace. I bear them record. They have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. They going about to establish their own righteousness have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to every one that believeth. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. The verses I've just quoted are in Romans chapter 10. They fell from the lips of God to the ears of the Apostle Paul, and through his inspired pen, he wrote them down. The man who said, my knowledge of the mystery came by revelation. Now let me tell you something in the closing moments of my broadcast. Are you listening? If you will bow your head and simply put your trust in the shed blood of Jesus, you will immediately become a member of the body of Christ, a member of His body. You will become a partaker of divine nature. The Holy Ghost will take up His abode in your bosom if you'll just bow your head, shut your eyes, confess your sins, and say, Lord Jesus, I believe you were and are the virgin-born Son of God. You died on a cross that buried you, and God raised you from the dead. I believe you are the crucified, risen Son of God. Save me now. If you'll pray that prayer, God will save you. You'll become a member of the body of Christ and a partaker of divine nature. But I warn you, unless you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and receive Him by faith, you'll never step inside the pearly gates. Father, thank you for the revelation you gave to Paul. Thank you, Father, for the precious book of Ephesians and Romans and the other books that you dictated to the Apostle Paul. Thank you, Father, for the Word. Honor thy Word, honor the blood. Save the soul that's nearest hell now. In Jesus' precious saving name, amen. Amen.